Welcome to the TI Precision Labs discussing EMI noise reduction techniques. The presence of electromagnetic interference in electronic systems can produce unwanted side effects, such as a degradation in performance or even failure to meet product specs. In this module, we'll discuss common clock design techniques for reducing emissions. Before we review the EMI mitigation techniques, let's quickly review EMI and EMC. Electromagnetic interference, or EMI, is basically any unwanted RF signal that disturbs an electrical circuit. What is EMC? This acronym for electromagnetic compatibility is where electrical and electronic systems can function with acceptable operation in their intended electromagnetic environment. EMC is achieved by limiting the different factors that may cause EMI. There are several standards bodies, national and international, that publish EMC standards. Electronic systems must be tested in compliance with all applicable standards to ensure compliance with state laws and regulations. EMC testing is conducted to determine the level of unwanted radiation interference. This example graph shows the amplitude of the electromagnetic field strength against a requirement mask across the frequency spectrum. In EMC scan testing, emissions can be measured using peak detection as well as a quasi-peak type measurement. While peak measurement only indicates the maximum amplitude of the spectral content, quasi-peak measurements weight the frequency peaks based on their rep rate or repetition rate. Some quasi-peak values in blue are exceeding the green quasi-peak limit line, indicating an emissions test failure. The many clock frequencies in electronic systems are among the main contributing factors to EMC violations. Clocks operate with high spectral energy at the carrier frequency, and often you'll see harmonics as well. Multiple clock frequencies can exacerbate EMI due to an increased number of mixing frequencies resulting in broadband radiation. The tabulated results shown correspond to the horizontal quasi-peak measurements in the plot on the previous slide. The peak frequencies are at harmonics of 50 MHz, indicating that a 50 MHz clock may be causing these EMC failures. EMI can have a negative impact on a system performance, and improving a design for EMC robustness can be a complex process that involves lots of time and money. Now we have introduced EMC and EMI, let's discuss some common design techniques to help reduce electromagnetic interference from clocks. Spread spectrum clocking, or SSC, is a highly effective technique used to combat EMI. SSC is typically spread as a percentage of the clock frequency. Typical values you may see include plus or minus 0.5%, 1%, and 2%. This figure shows how a spread spectrum clock appears in the frequency domain. You can see from the curves a larger spread corresponds to lower spectral peaks and less EMI. SSC benefits emissions by spreading the energy of a clock signal from a single tone to a specified bandwidth, thereby reducing the peak amplitudes of the carrier frequency and the harmonics. In the time domain, this is accomplished by dynamically adjusting the clock period. You may say, wait a minute, won't this cause other problems in the data receiver or transmitter? In most cases, the SSC frequency is low enough it can be tracked out by the receiver clock recovery circuit, and SSC is actually a supported feature for many communication standards such as PCIe. Center spread SSC, as in the previous slide, modulates the carrier frequency above and below the nominal frequency. Downspread SSC, however, only modulates the carrier frequency below the nominal frequency. You can see from the plot on the right, the upper edge of the SSC bandwidth coincides with the nominal frequency. One might use downspread rather than center spread when clocking a device with stringent requirements on the input frequency or setup and hold times. For example, if you have a microcontroller that accepts 100 MHz maximum input frequency, then you could use a 100 MHz clock with downspread SSC. The figure here depicts the time domain waveform for a 32 MHz spread spectrum clock. You can probably tell from the plot it's a triangular function. Looking closer, we see it has a plus or minus 2% center spread SSC at a repetition rate of 45.2 kHz. SSC rates are typically below 50 kHz and have a negligible impact on EMI performance. For EMC designs with stringent requirements, always consider using SSC in the clock tree for a significant reduction in emissions. To evenly distribute the frequency components of the SSE clock, a special function is used to sweep through the spread frequency range. Other spread functions besides triangular exist as well. For example, the Hershey-Kiss profile offers better performance compared to the other functions shown. However, the implementation is a little bit more complex than compared to the common triangular shape. Replacing these linear ramps with a pseudo-random frequency pattern is another recent technique to provide additional EMI reduction. The rising and falling edges of digital signals can generate EMI at harmonic frequencies. In the frequency domain, an ideal square wave consists of spectral energy localized at the fundamental frequency and its odd harmonic. Compare this to an ideal sine wave, which consists of spectral energy localized only at its fundamental tone. The presence of the higher order harmonics corresponds to the sharpness of the clock edges. In the real world, a square wave will not transition between logic levels instantaneously, and it is hard to find a perfect sine wave. Many clock signals are generally square wave shaped. For performance-intensive applications, sharp clock edges are often desired because faster edge rates will not impact the noise floor at the output of the clock device. Slower edge rates increase the phase noise floor, increasing the jitter at the clock output. The faster edge rates may create EMC problems, however. This figure is a spectrum measurement of 38.4 MHz square wave with very fast 300 picosecond edges, compared to a measurement of a 38.4 MHz sine wave. As you can see, the amplitude of the harmonics shown are significant compared to the carrier frequency. Additionally, the presence of even harmonics on a square wave indicates a duty cycle that deviates from 50%. Another common technique for controlling EMI is controlling the clock slew rate. In order to reduce the amplitude of the harmonics, simply reduce the slew rate of the clock edges. The rise-fall time of the edges of the square wave impacts the shape of the spectrum. Take a look at our trapezoidal clock waveform and its spectral envelope. Reducing the slew rate or increasing the rise time will decrease the amplitude of the harmonics, thereby reducing EMI. Slew rate control functionality can be incorporated into clocking devices to modify the edge rate. The slew rate control feature allows one to select the optimum slew rate for the application by register programming or pin control. A slower slew rate setting benefits radiated emissions, while a higher slew rate benefits jitter performance. Another common technique for reducing the output slew rate is using a small series resistance to reduce the clock edge rate. When designing clock traces using transmission line techniques, the resistor slows edges by absorbing reflections at the driver output. This technique will work best for shorter transmission lines, where the transmission line travel time is at least one order of magnitude lower than the clock period. Typically, a resistor from 0 to 33 ohms is placed at the output of the interfering clock device with the fast edge rates. Outside of these techniques we have discussed today, board-level strategies for EMI reduction could include the use of power supply filtering and solid decoupling at the supply pins of clock ICs. Differential signaling will also offer EMI improvement compared to single-ended clocks due to common mode rejection and the cancellation of equal and opposite magnetic fields. That concludes this video on EMI reduction techniques. Thank you for watching. If you need more information or technical resources on TI clocks and timing products, please visit ti.com and type in /clocks. If you'd like to test your knowledge, we have a short quiz right after this.